we know here in our region, I mean, they bring a myriad of hazards, not just the downdrafts or gust fronts we don't talk about with all those terms need, but severe weather control as well. So let's get into it. As Steve said before, fire is the number one of your standard fire order, heat warning, weather conditions forecast at all times. I wasn't there, you know, we weren't there on that particular incident that Steve just talked about, but if you need a weather briefing, I mean, if there's not an incident meteorologist there, weather service offices are open 24/7, 365. So if there's somebody back at dispatch that you got, I need weather now, I need to know what's going on with this incident, that's what we're there for. I mean, we have people there staffed all the time. So that goes for our service area all across the country. There's a weather service office open there to support, you know, boots on the ground, if you will, if there's not an IMET on site. So keep that in our back pocket, especially for dispatch. You know, we're there to help support you guys. Weather, going back to our fire triangle is the most variable of all the components influencing the fire environment. So what I have here, it's a little hard to see here, but we're down in the desert southwest, and what we're looking at is what we call radar reflectivity. So basically where you see the blobs of orange and red are pretty intense showers and thunderstorms. And we have a fire going on right over here. So my question to all of you guys and girls is, do you think these thunderstorms, and they're pretty far away, they're about 30 to 50 miles away, have the potential for impacting that particular fire site? Yes?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Is there any no's? Like, nah, that's pretty far away. Nobody? All right. Anybody know what this incident is?
You're probably
RNL. The RNL incident. So that band of thunderstorms that was at times 34 miles away produced an outflow. It's also called a gust front that traveled that far south and trapped these gentlemen. And we lost 19 of them on that particular day. So that's why we're hitting this pretty hard today. It influences the thunderstorms on our environment. So we, of course, give you about 30, 40 minutes. We're talking about a thunderstorm environment. We're in Florida. We're a prime environment for thunderstorm formation. Thunderstorm life cycle and a little bit of climatology, not too technical, I promise. And then we're going to get on potential impacts for you guys out in the field. And then we're going to talk about some ways to proactively monitor for thunderstorm potential in our area. Okay, so thunderstorms, all of them have lightning. Okay? It's one part of the definition of being a thunderstorm. It has to produce lightning. There's potential for gusty and variable winds, as we all know. Hail, severe weather even, in terms of tornadoes. In an environment that's conducive to producing thunderstorms, it's very unstable, going back to our 190-290-390 terms. Therefore, it has potential to even start popping up some fire whirls. Okay? So all kinds of crazy stuff can happen. And as we've been talking about, winds from thunderstorms, even distant thunderstorms, can result in sudden and erratic wind shifts well away from rainfall area. So just to kind of parallel how a thunderstorm is similar in ways to a fire is where you have that heat that's raising up over a fire site that creates an area of low pressure. Okay, literally when we talk about high pressure and low pressure, we're literally talking about air that's rising up from a certain point. That's lower air pressure pushing down because that air is escaping away from that point. Okay, if we have air that's sinking, being compressed down, that's high pressure. So for a fire, as that warm air rises up, it gradually begins to cool. And then the upper level of the atmosphere, we actually can start having sinking motion going down over here. So this would be higher pressure. So you get like this fire circulation that's going on. The hotter, the more intense the fire is, it's going to draw in more inflow going up into it. So to parallel that to a thunderstorm, for a thunderstorm, you have your low pressure on one side of the storm and your high pressure on the other side of the storm. So this is a cross-section. Don't worry about all these rings and clouds and everything. So this is a classic cross-section of a thunderstorm. There's two main parts. You have your inflow area. This is your low pressure area. And that air is rising up above the Earth's surface. And on this side, this is your rainfall area. This is what we call the downdraft area. Okay, out west, you might not have rain coming down, but you still have downdraft. Okay, and we'll talk about some visual clues of the downdraft side of the storm in a little bit. So the two main parts of a thunderstorm. Updraft. are relative to these two main sections of a storm, because we're in high heaven, we have low elevation. But if you can't get out and try to sense where, okay, I see the rain shaft coming down over there, there's no rain coming over there, that will help kind of gauge you in terms of where you're at relative to some of the storm's potential impacts. Now, there is another current of air, if you will, and this is what causes a lot of the erratic wind shifts that have caused many fatalities and entrapments. And this is something called a gust front. This is the phenomenon that we're talking about when you get your fire weather forecast, your spot forecast, it says gusty and erratic wind shifts can be expected from thunderstorms. From this gust front. So what the gust front is when this colder downdraft air, where the rainfall is, descends down from the storm, that air impacts the ground and it pushes out along the Earth's surface. And it radiates away from the downdraft area where the rainfall is coming down. And it travels out in all directions. And as it does so, it can impact you guys. The lightning capital of the United States, with it being the lightning capital, it's the thunderstorm capital. The lightning capital of the world is actually Africa. So, just so you know. Alright, so why are we such a thunderstorm prone environment? Well, since we're a peninsula, we're surrounded by bodies of water. So anytime we have, it's kind of hard to see here, but this is the state of Florida. Anytime we have an easterly wind or a wind that's coming off the Atlantic or a southerly wind or a west-southwest wind, we have air that's being blown across our region that's taking on moisture because it's been over these bodies of water. The only time we have a really dry flow, a dry pattern, is this time of year after a cold front when we have a wind coming in from the west, or I should say north to northwest. That air is being blown at us from over the continental air mass. But most of the times of the year, especially in the warm season during the summertime, we have moisture in place. Now, to start getting the clouds up warm, we have to have something called instability. And my first question to all you guys and girls is, what thing in outer space warms our atmosphere? How many for the sun? How many are that? Uh-uh, she sent me up. The Earth. The Earth warms our own atmosphere. All right, the sun warms us up, and when we go up on top of mountains, it should be a lot hotter, right? Because we're closer to the heat source. But it's actually colder. So the Earth, our atmosphere is actually transparent to the first waves of incoming sunlight. The Earth is something in physics called a black body. The Earth soaks up that heat and then re-radiates that heat to our own atmosphere. And so that thing, the ozone layer that everybody's freaking out, everybody's eroding, the ozone layer is like the big insulating blanket that traps in the heat that the Earth is emitting. Okay? So that's why, you know, up in the sky when you're up in the airplane or whatever, it's much colder up there than it is down at sea level. Alright, so teach your kids. It's the Earth that warms up our atmosphere. Alright, so basically when we talk about instability, the greater the contrast between the warm air down near the Earth's surface and the colder air aloft, the more this cold, dense air wants to sink downward and it can force that warmer, more moist air upward. So during the summertime, you know, we're, you know, 95 degrees at the surface down here, way high up, that's pretty cold air. So we have a pretty big contrast. That warm air is forced upward by that colder air that's sinking downward during the daytime. And if that low-level warm air has moisture in it, as it rises up, it cools and condenses and starts to form clouds. Well, to really help initiate these clouds and stay in these nice, tight, little, puffy cumulus clouds, like stuff we'd see outside probably in the summer between like 11 and 1 o'clock in the afternoon, just these nice little cauliflower-looking clouds, what really helps initiate them grow upward is when we have a source of lift. And in this case, it's some type of frontal boundary, like the sea breeze front, and we'll talk about that here coming up, which brings us our showers and storms most of the time during the summer. Or we can even have the lake breeze, Lake George here. We even have a river breeze with the St. John's River in some parts, like up close to NES Jacksonville. It's really wide up there near that part of the river, 3 miles across. We actually get a river breeze that sets up. So when I talk about a source of lift, I'm talking about some type of frontal boundary. If we were looking at a weather map, this would have little blue triangles on it indicating it's a cold front. So in this schematic, this is colder, dense air. Say this is some air that's coming down from Canada. And out ahead of that front, this is warmer, relatively more moist air. So as this front shifts southward, it's forcing that warmer, moist air upward ahead of it. And that air is able to cool and condense and it grows perfectly. And at some point, if it gets tall enough, if this cloud gets tall enough, we'll start to accumulate ice crystals way, way up high, and we start having ice crystals rub up against each other, and that promotes lightning development. So at that point, we'd have a thunderstorm. So that's usually during our cool season, when we start getting these cool fronts come through and bring with us these squall lines. This, once we get into the warm season, it's more slippery fronts, and we'll talk about that here coming up. Okay, so life cycle, I already kind of alluded to this. All of them start out, all thunderstorms start out as these nice little innocent cauliflower clouds, we call cumulus clouds, little puffy cumulus. And this is the building stage, okay? It's all updraft, okay? And we have the two main currents there that fuel or go into a storm. We have the updraft on one side, we have the downdraft on the other side. So this is all updraft. This is warm, moist air rising up, cooling, condensing, just forming the clouds. The cloud continues to grow vertically, taller, taller. At that point, it might become a mature thunderstorm, meaning that it's producing lightning. So on this side, we have an updraft, and then we have our downdraft, our two main currents of air. It's a little hard to see, but this picture here is a mature thunderstorm. In the background, this is an upper-level cloud. It's called the amble cloud. So that's this cloud way up here. And down in the foreground, we see the tight cumuliform shapes, like the puppy shape. That is where the updraft's going up into the storm. So kind of to help you reference, you know, where you're at in the field, like scanning the sky. If you look off in the distance, when you see the tight cumuliform shape like that, like the cauliflower-looking shape, that's cloud growth still generating. Okay, that's the updraft. That's condensation. All that stuff's still growing. In the background, when you see that cloud form that's a little bit more wispy and kind of fuzzy looking, that part of the storm's dying off, okay? So if you're looking for the potential of, hey, that sucker's getting taller and kind of billowing a little bit more, becoming more puffy and cumuliform, that's still growing. That's where the updraft's going up. So just something to kind of scan for your for thunderstorm potential out in the field. And then typically what kills the storm is when this rain-cooled air comes down and impacts the surface and creates that thing called the gust front that we talked about earlier. That gust front pushes out along the Earth's surface, and most of the time, especially in the summertime, when that gust front air can cut off this updraft, that's when the storm becomes downdraft dominant. There's no more inflow going up into it, so it rains out, and you can see there's a discrepancy, but this thunderstorm there was kind of fizzy and wispy, and it's dying out, so there's no more juice going up into it. All right, so this is a radar reflectivity. This is from the Melbourne Doppler radar. And just for reference, this is the Atlantic Ocean over here. This is the Cape. Anybody know what this long line is right here?
Sea breeze.
Very nice. Okay, so not too much in terms of precipitation going on with the sea breeze. The cooler the colors, the lighter the rain, so maybe some sprinkles, maybe just a few spits coming down with it. But just west of the sea breeze, we have a thunderstorm, a lone thunderstorm right here. Now just looking at radar, one little slice of the radar, you can't tell it's a thunderstorm because you don't have lightning overlaid. So just because you see red, it does not mean lightning's going on. But the hotter the colors do indicate more intense precipitation, so heavier rainfall coming down. Now the original storm splits into two. You guys see that circle shape? What's that? It is moving, so I'm going to guess it's not a lake. Okay. Anybody else? So wind phenomenon we just talked about is the gust front. It's that air that's coming down, it impacts the ground, it pushes out away from the thunderstorm, from the base of it, but it's rising up just a little bit to where we actually get on radar, we see a density gradient, but we're actually going to see the outflow, the gust front. Now, when this gust front, when that airflow comes in, watch what happens when it hits the sea breeze. What happens? Boom! You get a whole other cell that forms. So you have this gust front meet up with the sea breeze. The air can't go down, that's where the ground is. So it's forced upward, and we get a whole other storm that grows because it's a moist, unstable environment. by thunderstorms, you know, we can look to where some of these boundaries might be coming together. Now, the caveat is the farther away from the radar site we are, we're not going to be able to see these low-level little boundaries and gust fronts. But when you aren't close enough to a radar site and you see these little boundaries, very weak, not really intense to come together, during the summertime, during the warm season, you can pretty much bet your bottom dollar that another storm is going to grow there. Now, also, what I want to illustrate here is this is the gust front. Even though it looks like it goes away here, it's still pushing southward. So if somebody was burning over here, oh, we got a storm up there, we got sea breeze coming in, you know, they might be preparing for an easterly wind shift with the sea breeze, but they're probably going to have a wind shift come in from the north first before that gust front even gets to, or before the sea breeze even gets to, because the gust front got to them first. Okay? So when we talk about these gusty and erratic winds shifting from thunderstorms, it's the gust fronts. Okay, thunderstorm climatology. We're in the cool season, and typically for our area, our cool season is like mid-October through mid-May-ish. And this time of year, this is when we start looking for these squall lines. Now, thankfully, but for my area of responsibility, we cover North Florida, South Georgia. Most of the stronger squall line activity that's been coming ahead of these cold fronts has been across Central and South Florida, like a little bit south of us. But we are getting some of the rain. So these squall lines, they develop ahead of these stronger cold fronts, and it's where we get these bands of showers and storms, and usually a more intense line sets up at some point ahead of these cold fronts. But with these types of thunderstorms, I mean, usually it's pretty well organized, and you can time it pretty well. Once it clears out, most of the time, unless the front stalls, it's done. And you can kind of plan a little bit more accordingly. At the head of the main front, down across Bradford, Clay, Palatine County, like down here where Gainesville is, there's some pop-up showers and storms ahead of the main line. So this is more typical, like I said, during the cool season. During our warm season, we get the sea breezes that set up, and these thunderstorms that develop, I have some graphics coming up that will illustrate the sea breezes a little bit more. But these storms that develop, the sea breezes develop along the coast, the west coast, the east coast, but as I said before, we can also get a river breeze and lake breezes. So these boundaries push inland through the course of the day, and when they come together, depending on how strong the winds are, on below-level winds, that's when we get a lot more sense in a minute, when they come together, boom, that's where you get your big blow-up of showers and storms during the afternoon. All right, so since this is such a weather determinator for our area during the warm season, the way the sea breezes work is we're going to focus on this part of the graphic first, okay? And we're going to pretend we're down in South Florida. This is the Florida Peninsula, and we're looking northward, okay? So the sun comes out during the day, it heats the land warms up, and the air above it starts to warm up, and it starts to rise, okay? Warm air wants to rise, it's more buoyant. So as that air rises up, we have air that's lifting away from a point, that's lower pressure, okay? So we have something called a thermal low in meteorology that develops over the state of Florida, okay? The hotter the temperatures get, the more intense that air is rising up. So to replace that air that's rising, we have to bring in air from another direction. And that's brought in from the Gulf and then from the Atlantic to our east. So that air begins to go into it. Kind of similar to a fire, right? You have your heat going on in the middle, it's rising up. You got to draw in more inflow to keep that circulation going. Sea, gale, and weather. All right, so we're drawing in this air. But this air that's coming in, it's not dry air that's over the land. It's coming in from either the moist Atlantic or the Gulf. And so as that air starts to come in and it's getting heated, it cools and starts to form clouds. So if you ever look at satellite imagery on a typical summer day, you'll see these bands of clouds set up along the Atlantic coast. You'll see them set up along Lake George. You'll see it set up along St. John's River. Those are these little breezes, these little boundaries that are starting to set up. So through the course of the day, the more intense heating that goes on, you have to draw in more air to keep that circulation going. So these sea breezes will actually move inland through the course of the day. And so this is what this graph is kind of trying to show you. All right, so these sea breezes move inland, get more hotter, humidity continues to be pretty high, the clouds will become more congested, you might have some pop-up showers and isolated on the individual sea breezes or just inland, but when they come together during the usually late afternoon, early evening hours, it has to be a big blow up, all that air scores upward, and you get that big line of showers and storms that sets up. So what actually dictates which sea breeze is going to be stronger or move inland faster during the course of the day is this big area of high pressure. It sits out over the Atlantic Ocean, and wind flow goes clockwise around areas of high pressure. So for us, if the center part of this high, all right, it's called the Bermuda High, is just north of us, then we're going to have a stronger east wind on that given day. So that means we know we're going to get these sea breezes that set up. That east coast sea breeze is going to push inland faster. It's going to move inland, you know, east or push west of St. John's River Basin probably by late morning, early afternoon. And so our showers and storms are going to be over with on this side of the peninsula, but it's going to rendezvous with the west coast sea breeze, generally along the I-75 corridor during the late afternoon or early evening hours. If that center part of that high is south of us, then here we're going to get a stronger southwest flow. And this is our wetter pattern, okay, when we have more shower and thunderstorm activity. That west coast sea breeze is going to push inland faster than the east coast. And then they hook up on the I-95 St. John's River Basin corridor. If we have a south wind, then, whoops, where's my south wind? Okay, disregard. Alright, if we had a south wind, right, which typically happens, very light south wind, if the ridge is sitting right up over us, what do you guys think the sea breezes would do? They're still setting up, they're still moving, but where are they going to hook up?
I-4.
We're going to get it up here. Watch out. The sea breezes are going to move inland at about the same speed, and they're going to hook up during, across the middle part of the state, and then probably affect portions of I-4. Okay, so this is radar loop from 98. Kind of hard to see here. This is North Florida. You guys see a little bit over here before we talk about that sucker. The sea breeze, the East Coast sea breeze setting up right here. So there's puffy clouds setting up, a low line, and then clear skies out of the Atlantic Ocean here. This was a very, as you know, busy fire year for us. Up here, we have a fire, wildfire that's going on, and then when the west coast sea breeze, it's kind of hard to see, but there's actually a differential line right here between the puffy clouds and clear skies. When the west coast sea breeze pushes across that fire site, what happens? Holy cow, right? It just blows up, so it's, that air that's already rising up over the fire site is intersected by another boundary, which is breeze, that air flows forced upward more vigorously, and you actually get a thunderstorm that forms over the fire in this particular case when the sea breeze went through. Okay, so thunderstorm hazards, lightning happens with all thunderstorms. It's so inconvenient, but the lightning safety rule is when thunder roars, go indoors. My six-year-old daughter loves to promote this when we're shopping at Publix. And she hears thunder. She like yells at people, "The thunder! Get yourself inside! Thunder roars, go indoors!" I'm like, but anyway, so it's inconvenient for us as Floridians. You know, my husband's out there mowing the backyard. Honey, you've got a storm coming in. I can get the front yard mowed. No, come on in. But it's the lightning safety rule. With our previous rain event, a storm system squall line coming in, during the early morning hours, we had a lady struck in Lake City. She was working at one of the schools there, a gal helping the kids get in, you know, early morning, dropping your kids off. There wasn't lightning for miles. There was lightning around. But it wasn't, you know, boom, boom, boom kind of event. It was one of the first strikes in the whole county. But there was thunderstorms in the forecast. The ingredients for thunderstorm formation were there. And unfortunately, she was struck. She survived, but she was very lucky. The lightning is so inconvenient for us, but it's actually our number one weather killer in Florida, other than rip currents. So if you guys being out there in the field quite often, start hearing rumbles of thunder, I know you've got some objectives you want to meet, but it's definitely time to start wrapping it up. You've got thunderstorms in the area. So if you do get stuck out there, and say you have a dozer or something, an engine out there, as a last resort, you know, definitely get in there and help you down from the storm. The key is you don't want to be touching metal of your vehicle. If your be touching anything that's metal that goes to the outside, okay? Not the rubber tires that keep you safe. That's a, BS myth. So, just hunker down, but don't be touching any kind of metal that goes out the side. Because the metal shell of the vehicle is actually what's going to help save you, because the current goes around the shell of the car and disperses down through the ground. Flooding. It's kind of hard to see here, but these are images that I took on the fire that was at in Washington a couple summers ago. We had mudslides. And me being a Florida girl, it was an experience forecasting mountain meteorology. We had like gap winds, and they had literally around a tenth of an inch of rain up here. This is one of the spot fires that were near the incident complex. Tenth of an inch of rain up here, about 1300, right up here on this range, caused a mudslide. So I was not expecting such impacts, but it dumped on top of a burn scar. All that stuff that ran on down the side of the mountain. And this is pictures of the Intiot River Road where the mud came across. So it dumped right on top of Bird's car. They had one vehicle that got stuck in like a couple feet of mud, and then peel it out. Everybody was okay. But that was a huge lesson learned for me. Down here we can take 2 to 4 inches of rainfall, no problem. Out west, 10th of an inch, holy cow, on top of Bird's car, that's like. So, in addition to mud and debris slides, flooding can be misleading in our area. We think it's a muddy puddle. We try driving through it. Oh my gosh, it might be a sinkhole. So I have some images of, well, not funny because it's been my mom. Gals driving through and guys driving through parking lots, and they think it's a muddy puddle, and the vehicle keeps going down. It's a sinkhole. So if you don't know how deep it is, don't go into it. For us, there could be creepy crawlies in it, all kinds of stuff. So don't know how deep it is, don't go into it. Another thunderstorm hazard is hail. For hail, it forms in the upper levels of the storm. So these are the stages of thunderstorm development, so updraft, downdraft here. So the hailstones form way up high where it's really, really cold. And they can grow. They grow through a process called aggregation. So you'll get like these smaller sizes that form first. And as they get tossed back down, maybe they sink down into lower levels of the storm a little bit and warm up. Because remember, when we go lower, it gets warmer. Higher up, it gets colder. So as they get tossed back down to lower levels, they'll melt a little bit and they'll get a ring of water around them. And then they'll get tossed back up again into the upper levels of the storm. So this is how you get really big hailstones that form. And so this is a hail that was near Gainesville. And you can see how this one big piece is made up of all these smaller pieces. So eventually what happens most of the time is this updraft, that hail gets too heavy. You can't keep it up there anymore. It becomes too heavy. So the updraft says, all right, you're coming down. So the storm begins to collapse, and the hail begins to come down towards the surface. Now, thankfully for us, we're in such a moisture-laden and tropical environment that by the time this hail reaches the surface, it's melted. We just get a big downpour, fat raindrops. But even when it's like 95 degrees outside, we get these big, tall, 56,000 foot storms, there's hail that's growing up in there. Just by the time it reaches us, it's melted. But sometimes atmospherics are such where we can get ice that falls down. Now, as this hail falls down through the storm, it gains speed, it gains momentum. And that can create another phenomenon called a downdraft. So we have the main downdraft part of the storm, but this is when the storm begins to collapse. Maybe the hail got too heavy, the storm begins to collapse. So that current of air comes down through the core of the storm, and it impacts the ground. So maybe there's, it's kind of hard to see here, but there's a mass, a ball right here. Comes down, impacts the ground, and that current of air pushes out along the Earth's surface at a high velocity, a high rate of speed. And that's a type of wind that can cause a lot of damage. That's one of the things we issue severe thunderstorm warnings for, is when we think that downburst wind can be over 58 miles an hour or more. So that type of wind levels things. So we have these big oaks that get pushed over by these strong winds. And scraggly pines that you have around here can snap quite often in the upper portions of the tree by one of these strong wind events. So we do issue severe thunderstorm warnings for these. This is one of the things we issue severe thunderstorm warnings for. Does anybody know what the other one was? I had it on the previous slide. Hail, that's what size or larger?
Greater than an inch.
Quarter size or larger. Those are the only two things we issue severe thunderstorm warnings for. polygon. So I have a couple of radar signatures here that just little clues that we look for to see if storms might be capable of producing really strong downburst winds like this. This is a squall line of storms. The hot colors are the intense rainfall. And this is a radar signature called a bow echo. And that can indicate that strong winds are coming down towards the surface and causing that part of the squall line to bow out ahead. So right at the apex of this radar signature, a bow can indicate really strong winds, severe strength winds. And this is a, something else from our radar that might be too much information, but I'll show it to anybody. Our radar site, Jacksonville, is up here. And this is a downburst wind signature from something we call velocity. So most of the radar stuff you're familiar with is reflectivity, but there's something else called velocity. And what velocity shows us, it lets us know what the winds are doing in the atmosphere. So where you see green is wind flow towards the radar, and what you see red is wind flow away from the radar. So basically what happened here is we had a big impact site underneath the thunderstorm happen, boom, right here, Bayard's down over here, just to give you a point of reference. South side of Jacksonville, UNF, University of North Florida, right here. Mayport's up here. So boom, you have that impact right here, and that strong current of wind pushed out along the Earth's surface. Now, it is going in this direction, too. It's just our radar is not able to sample it. So it is radiating out at a very high rate of speed, and that's such a strong downburst that that's going to continue for many, many miles, even far away from where the rainfall is even occurring, right? These are the types of winds that can impact those who are in the field, fires, well away, even outside of the county, because its impact is such a high rate of speed and pushing out with such force. So indicators of downdrafts close to obviously rainfall. So we have some rain shafts coming down here, rainfall coming down here. This is a storm that's actually collapsing, so we see kind of the lowering of the clouds. That indicates that air is moving its way down. Out west, and you actually see here sometimes, a phenomenon called virga. So that's rainfall that's coming down under, on the downdraft side of the storm, but the low levels of the atmosphere are so dry that the rainfall is evaporating. So even though the rain's not reaching the surface, it doesn't mean that strong winds couldn't come down and impact the ground. So these are some visual indicators that, okay, we got some wind that's coming down and coming down towards the surface. As I said before, in an environment that can support thunderstorm growth, it's highly unstable, and we can actually promote, it can promote fire whirl development. Okay, so it's just something else to keep in the back of our minds. So this is an event, and I know Ms. Rose is going to go over this in much more detail, but this is a fire event that we had down to the south of us. And we have our line of storms up here, well to the north, and actually a couple of little broken lines here. And this is back in 2004. Would you consider these storms a threat to the fire? They're out there burning that day. You're like, oh gosh, she set me up, of course. All right, so yes, indeed. As we go through time, these are hourly radar loops. So we get a little bit more organization to the line starting to set up. This is at 19 Zulu. About 2 hours after, you start seeing actually right here a little bit of a, this is called, you guys remember, gust front starting to set up. So these storms up here produce the gust front. Still going through time here. So boom, it's already going to go to the fire site. So they got actually a significant wind shift with this. And I'm not going to go into it too much, but this is a little bit of the aftermath. Bigger river. So that's the St. Sebastian River Preserve burns, and Ms. Rose is going to cover that in a minute. So to help monitor the thunderstorm potential where you're at, check out the weather service. Call us. We won't bite that hard. But we're there 24/7. There's always these two meteorologists at the station. And you know, put us in contact. You know, talk to your dispatcher. You know, who's requesting the spot? Let us know in the spot forecast, you know, that you have sensitivity, you know, you're going to be burning here. Please give a number for call heads up, a thunderstorm activity, something like that. We're happy to help out. So most of the Weather Service web pages are set up the same similar way. If you want to visit your local Weather Service office, shoot somebody there an email or email me, and I'll find whoever the contact is. You know, we're there to help support you guys in the field. All the Weather Service pages have a fire weather link. This is just an example of the National Weather Service Jacksonville fire weather page. stuff on there. Or, you know, get your forecast, spot request. You know, there should be an email link to whoever is, you know, the fire weather program leader in that particular office. So, but wherever you go, the office page should be a little bit different, but check it out. The map there that's on all the web service home pages, the one in the middle of the page, not the top map, this is just kind of a forecast graphic. But click on that map anywhere, and you can actually get a site-specific forecast to a latitude, longitude, and I'll show you a little bit more about this a little later on. I think this road is going to cover this too. So you can actually use this map, click on it initially, and the page will load. And then there's a more refined map, I think it's Esri that does the mapping for us now. And you can actually zoom in to a specific lat long, and the forecast that you have available, it's hard to see here, but up here is a specific lat long. You can get these hourly weather trends, this is temperature, this is dew point, this is wind. Down here we have relative humidity, and there's more and more that you can add. You can add fire weather parameters, mixing heights, transport winds, all this good stuff, and we actually do that. The fire weather stuff goes out to about 2 days. The other parameters, like the dew points and RHs, that goes out for 7 days. Are we going to be right with the dew point at 2 p.m. on day 7? No. But we're good at forecasting trends. So you can see, okay, well, storm system next week's coming a little bit faster. I might be able to burn on Wednesday. Nope, looks like it might be hanging up now. Okay, maybe I can have burn on Thursday or Friday. So this is a good tool. And we do, in our office, we keep this updated the first 24 hours. So we get observations in. We want to tweak our forecast, try to match observations as much as possible. And then, as I said before, you know, fire. So some of us are incident meteorologists, and I love to get out on burns. So if anybody is doing a burn, shoot me an email. I'd love to have there. I learn from you guys so much, and you know, new weather and all that stuff, and see how far off we are on our forecast and how we can make it better. Hopefully it's not far off. So our fire weather forecast goes out. A note of caution with these products, if you do look at them, these are a huge area average. So these are done over a big forecast zone. So for our office, we do these products on the county level. So this is a forecast for Columbia County. It averages up all of Columbia County, and it spits out an average RH, or our average temperature, through these 12-hour points. So we can provide better than that. We can actually, the way we prepare our products is graphically. So we create a map and interpolate between different data points, so we can actually provide a lat long specific forecast, hence your spot forecast. So just use this fire weather plane forecast as a very broad overview, because it's averaging all these specific points over a large area, like at the county level. And the spot forecast, that's where you're going to get your more refined point specific forecast, but you can get this through our website already without officially requesting a spot too, using that interface that you're doing. I have instructions up here how to get that interface too, if you guys are interested. Let me talk. So this is a new website too. I'm just about done. This was news to me. I went to a little workshop last week. And what this is the fire weather portal. So if you type in weather.gov/fire, and again, I have this website on this little sheet I'd like for you on the table, you'll come to this interactive map, okay? And it's not specific to a forecast office or a forecast of, you know, it's not Weather Service Jacksonville, it's not Weather Service Melbourne, it's just a generalized map. And so basically, anywhere on the map, all across the country, on the area that you're interested in, you need like a spot for. So my example here, I did in the middle of the National Forest here. So you click on that map, and then this little GUI will pop up. And this is saying, okay, approximately you're at this location, east-southeast of Fort McCoy, about 5 miles. And that's like a generalized forecast for that location. But down here, these are where you're going to get that more specific lat-long forecast. So you have an hourly weather graph, which is the line that I kind of showed you earlier. The digital tabular data is what I've heard most of our fire partners enjoy, because it's just numbers. And then there's this new one called tabular. So for this example, I'm going to click on this digital tabular product. So this is in complement to requesting a spot. Click on that, and then this is that lat long specific forecast. And it goes out through 7 days. You can put your fire parameters on there if you want to, and it will list on the whole page. It'll be like a running list. So thunderstorms in the forecast. You know, the winds, that's the general prevailing wind direction. Your wind might do some squirrely stuff with thunderstorms in the area. So that's where, you know, having a weather monitor back at the station can be very helpful. Okay, so proactive thunderstorm monitoring, check the forecast. When you're out in the field, you see little cumulus clouds that start out kind of fat or flat and shallow, and then they start growing taller, your thunderstorm potential is going up big time. If you do have a radar app, and you go from seeing these nice little cool pinprick colors on your radar to more intense red and yellow and all that good stuff, even if it's 30 miles away from you, prepare for the potential for outflows from these guys, okay? All right, so just in summary, outflows can impact fire sites many, many miles away from the rainfall area the storm's occurring. Thunderstorms in the forecast, lightning's expected, outflows, gust winds are likely, the environment is unstable,